Marlowe's famous epic poem Hero and Leander of 818 lines entered into the stationer's register in September 1593, 3 months after his alleged killing, but was not allowed to be printed. It appeared for the first time in print only 5 years later in 1598, not yet structured into any parts. Oddly enough, within months of the same year, two high-level poetical continuations of Marlowe's poem followed, written by George Chapman and Henry Petowe. This video tries to explain the literary background of the odd Hero and Leander Triple by integrating it into the Marlowe Shakespeare authorship issue, but let us start out at the beginning by comparing Marlowe's Hero and Leander with Shakespeare's Venus and Adonis. When comparing both poems, note, Venus and Adonis was registered in the same year than Hero and Leander, in 1593, striking similar phrasings, expressions and idioms, requiring a very close inner relationship of both authors, can be noticed. Shakespeare from Stratford can hardly have known Marlowe's epic poem Hero and Leander, or had access to it, since it was published only 5 years later in 1598. Analogies between Marlowe's and Shakespeare's poems are beyond any coincidence. This definitely needs an explanation. A few examples. In both poems, the term rose-cheeked is used to describe Adonis. In Venus and Adonis, rose-cheeked Adonis tried him to the chase.
In Hero and Leander, rose-cheeked Adonis kept a solemn feast. Or, thy rosy cheeks be to thy thumb inclined. In Marlowe's Ovid translation, she blushed, red shame becomes white cheeks.
Both poems refer to the mythological figure of Narcissus. In Venus and Adonis, Narcissus so himself forsook.
In Hero and Leander, those orient cheeks and lips, exceeding his, that leapt into the water for a kiss of his own shadow and, despising many.
Both poems associate an unruly horse to the behavior of a lover. In Venus and Adonis, the sea has bounds, but deep desire has none. Therefore no marvel, though thy horse be gone. How like a jade he stood, tied to the tree, servilely mastered with a leathern rein. But when he saw his love, his youth's fair fee, he held such petty bondage in disdain.
In Hero and Leander, for as a hot, proud horse highly disdains to have his head controlled, but breaks the reins, spits forth the ringled bit, and with his hooves checks the submissive ground, so he that loves.
In both poems, beloved sweet-smelling breath is mentioned, as also in Romeo and Juliet, and in Sonnet 99. In Venus and Adonis, sweet issue of a more sweet-smelling sire, in Romeo and Juliet, by any other name would smell as sweet. In Sonnet 99, sweet thief, whence didst thou steal thy sweet that smells, if not from my love's breath?
In Hero and Leander, many would praise the sweet smell as she passed.
Both poems associate the knight to the love act. In Venus and Adonis, the witch, by Cupid's bow she doth protest, he carries thence encaged in his breast. Sweet boy, she says, this night I'll waste in sorrow.
In Hero and Leander, some say for here the fairest Cupid pined, or breathed darkness forth, dark night is Cupid's day. Thus, having swallowed Cupid's golden hook, in Marlowe's Ovid translation, and Cupid who hath marked me for thy prey, All lovers war, and Cupid hath his tent. Will you, for gain, have Cupid sell himself? Till Cupid's bow, and fiery shafts be broken. So Cupid's will, far hence be the severe. No love is so dear, quivered Cupid, fly. So wavering Cupid brings me back again.
Both poems introduce the carpe diem motif. In Venus and Adonis. Make use of time, let not advantage slip. Beauty within itself should not be wasted.
In Hero and Leander. The richest corn dies, if it be not reaped. Beauty alone is lost, too warily kept.
Both poems form an analogy between fearful lovers and soldiers afraid of death. In Venus and Adonis. With cold pale weakness numbs each feeling part, like soldiers, when their captain once doth yield, they basely fly and dare not stay the field.
In Hero and Leander. To touch those dainties, she's the harpy played. And every limb did, as a soldier stout, defend the fort, and keep the foeman out.
Both poems allude to credulity, and trust, of a lover. In Venus and Adonis. O hard believing love! How strange it seems, not to believe, and yet, too credulous.
In Hero and Leander. Love is too full of faith, too credulous.
Both poems deal with the contrast between pity, or compassion, and human harshness. In Venus and Adonis. Are you obdurate, flinty, hard as steel? No, more than flint, for stone at rain relents.
In Hero and Leander. Relenting thoughts, remorse, and pity rests. And who have hard hearts and obdurate minds?
Both poems use similar analogies between a soft heart, bosom, and an immortal hand. In Venus and Adonis. Look how he can, she cannot choose but love. And by her fair immortal hand she swears, from his soft bosom never to remove.
In Hero and Leander. How smooth his breast was and how white his belly. And whose immortal fingers did imprint.
Both poems use the term, Queen of Love. In Venus and Adonis. Poor Queen of Love, in thine own lore forlorn.
In Hero and Leander. The gentle Queen of Love's sole enemy.
Both poems reflect on a person's altered behavior, being in a state of love. In Venus and Adonis. Banning his boisterous and unruly beast.
In Hero and Leander. Are of behavior boisterous and rough. Oh, shun me not, but hear me ere you go.
In Venus and Adonis. His love, perceiving how he is enraged, grew kinder, and his fury was assuaged.
In Hero and Leander. The might you see one sigh, another rage. And some, their violent passions to assuage.
Shouldn't it be time at last to rethink the authorship of William Shakespeare from Stratford, and eventually support a necessary paradigm shift, long overdue?
There was only one towering literary genius, Marlowe, forced to abandon his name and identity and write under a multiplicity of pen names including Shakespeare, but also Chapman, Petowe, and others.
Let's have a closer look to the other author names of the Hero and Leander Triple. Chapman and Petowe. Is it not weird? That in the same year, in 1598, in the same city, in London, the same topic, Hero and Leander, was published by three different authors, Marlowe, Chapman, Petowe, as a first, a second and a third sequel. No sensible person can really think that such a threefold activity of artistic, literary, and contextual development could have happened in such a short period of time, in the same place, at this high poetical level. It is not conceivable at all, and there is no plausible motif why two allegedly independent authors, Chapman and Petowe, within months of the first printing of Marlowe's Hero and Leander in 1598, felt the need and were able to complete and expand Marlowe's epic poem, which had just appeared. Is it not more likely to assume a completely different scenario, which explains the Hero and Leander triple situation in a more plausible way? Be aware. A plausible interpretation of this weird triple Hero and Leander situation in 1598 becomes possible only when accepting a Marlowe Shakespeare authorship issue. Let's first regard these three epic poems, their authors and their inner connections in some details. When Marlowe's original Hero and Leander was registered, September 1593, Marlowe had disappeared, died of the plague, according to a documented rumor of Gabriel Harvey, September 1593. Note. The first source of Marlowe's alleged killing is 4 years later. From Thomas Beard in 1597. No consensus exists on the issue of how Marlowe would have finished the poem, or indeed, if he would have finished it at all. Consider that Marlowe's poem does not end tragically. The two added final words, in its original first printed version 1598, De sunt non nulla, express that something is missing, or is not complete. These words, added by Edward Blunt, or even more likely by the still living author himself, can logically only originate from Marlowe, if he was not dead. The two final words seem to act as an announcement of an upcoming version, enlarged, under another name. Marlowe's Hero and Leander can, and should be, considered finished. If he had gone on, he would have had to deal along the original Greek tale, which in fact is a tragic denouement. Marlowe stopped short of death and tragedy, it would have been incompatible with Marlowe's allegoric version, a simile of his unfinished life story. Neptune allegorically took him down to the ocean until he realized that he confused him with immortal Ganymede and released him back to Earth. Note. Ganymede plays no role in Musa's ancient mythological tale, Hero and Leander. But Marlowe's first play Dido, Queen of Carthage in 1594. Believe it or not, begins with Ganymede. The dedication of the printed poem Hero and Leander to Marlowe's best friend Thomas Walsingham by the editor Edward Blunt in 1598, is full of ambiguous evidence of a concealed continued existence of Marlowe. Chapman's continuation of Hero and Leander, in the same year, accompanied the second printing of Marlowe's poem. It was this second, Chapman's version, who divided Marlowe's poem into two parts, calling them sestiads and added four sestiads with structured headings and summaries, also of early Marlowe's part, with an additional dedication to Lady Audrey Shelton, Thomas Walsingham's wife and Marlowe's closest friend.
Please note. The title cover of Chapman's continuation of Hero and Leander received a new evocative emblem. The metaphor, the deeper meaning of the allegoric marigold emblem, seems obvious. It symbolizes the dichotomous fate of its author, Christopher Marlowe. The left flower facing the sun widely open, representing his first life. The right flower being closed and benched downwards, facing darkness, clouds and rain, representing his second life, in obscurity, with a second identity, Chapman. The ribbon telling us, non licet exiguis that is, only for insiders.
Consider. Shakespeare's sonnet 25 also includes the marigold metaphor. It should be interpreted as a blueprint of the true author's fatal life situation. Listen, and reflect on Sonnet 25.
Let those, who are in favor with their stars, of public honor and proud titles boost, while I, whom fortune of such triumph bars, unlooked for joy, in that I honor most. Great princes' favorites their fair leaves spread, but as the marigold at the sun's eye, and in themselves their pride lies buried, for to frown, they in their glory die. The painful warrior, fame oust for worth, after a thousand victories once foiled, is from the book of honor raised quite, and all the rest forgot, for which he toiled. Then happy I, that love and am beloved, where I may not remove. Nor be removed.
It's unlikely and an utterly abstruse thought that the literary activity of Chapman, more or less identical to Shakespeare in time, age, and genius, may have started only after the death of Christopher Marlowe. In the fourth decade of his life, that is, Chapman's work did not overlap with Marlowe a single day? There is a multiplicity of serious arguments as to why the supposedly killed Marlowe extended his poem Hero and Leander under the pseudonym of Chapman and Petowe. Virtually nothing about Chapman's life you read today in encyclopedias can be considered secured. No reliable evidence affirms that he studied at Oxford but did not take a degree. In the dedication of Hero and Leander, Chapman's part, to Thomas Walsingham's wife Audrey Shelton, Chapman characterizes Lady Shelton's husband and his own hidden state as
with him, that is Thomas Walsingham, my honored best friend, whose continuance of ancient kindness to my still obscured estate, or to which the unhappiness of my life hath hitherto been uncomfortable and painful dumbness.
Be aware, expressions such as my still obscured estate, my unhappy and uncomfortable life, my painful dumbness, fit and should be associated with Marlowe, or only with Chapman, provided his name was a pseudonym of Marlowe. Conspicuous plagiarism by George Chapman from Marlowe's works lacks a comprehensible logic. An example. Chapman. As Flora to salute the morning sun, who, when she shakes her tresses in the air, rains on the earth dissolved pearl in showers.
Marlowe. And like Flora, in her morning's pride, shaking her silver tresses in the air, rainest on the earth, resolved pearl in showers.
Isn't it more plausible and more likely that Chapman was a pseudonym or pen name of Christopher Marlowe, than he stole from Marlowe those passages of text, in such a grotesque way? Note. Chapman's evocative first literary work in 1594, Opus 1, The Shadow of Night, bears all autobiographical traits and details of a previous disaster similar to Shakespeare's Lucrece in the same year. Both printed by Richard Field. For example, that I may quickly weep the shipwreck of the world. Or, let self sleep, binding my senses, loose my working souls. The motive of the author, Chapman, in 1594, to begin his literary career, with a hymn to his concealment. Consider Marlowe had to hide himself, he could move in public only at night. His blackout, his death, along with a hymn to the queen that is him in Cynthiam, can only become comprehensible, if Chapman was a pseudonym for Marlowe. Reflect on the possible meaning of the following exemplary, ambiguous, lines. Aspire the extraction, and the quintessence of all the joys in earth's circumference, with ghosts, fiends, monsters. As men robbed and racked. Mirthed in life, from shades with shadows blacked. Thunder your wrongs, your miseries and hells. And with the dismal accents of your knells. Revive the dead, and make the living die in ruth, and terror of your tortures. Still all the part of at into your groans. Consider. These lines represent not so much a sophisticated abstract poesy, but rather a deadly serious autobiography. Without constraint, the deeper content can be brought into line with Marlowe but not with Chapman. Already a century ago, J.M. Robertson, in his comparative analysis between Shakespeare and Chapman, came to the conviction that there is a close linguistic literary relationship between the authors, far beyond any coincidence, with a definite contribution of Chapman in Shakespeare's plays and poems such as Timon of Athens, Troilus and Cressida, Pericles, or A Lover's Complaint. Reflect on some thoughts of Robertson about Chapman. He wrote, Chapman was one of the most remarkable men of letters of his time. The time of Shakespeare, Marlowe, and Ben Jonson. In mere variety of energy and effort, mere multiplicity of strenuous production, ranging from successful comedy to cryptic and mystical poetry, he stands out noticeably among his most distinguished contemporaries. Having apparently no means of support, after 1593, save his pen, he contrived to produce his translations of the Iliad, the Odyssey, and the rest of Homer and to give them qualities of power and fire which make them to this day magnetic. Consider Ovid's creative impact and influence on Marlowe, alias Shakespeare, was most profound. The deliberately ambiguous dedicatory poem by J.D. John Davis. To the author, Chapman, in his Opus 2, Ovid's Banquet of Saints, in 1595. Becomes logic, understandable or plausible for Chapman only, if the name was a pseudonym of Marlowe. Listen first to some dedicatory sentences of John Davis. An impressive total equation of Chapman with Ovid. since Ovid's eyes were closed with iron sleep. But now his waking soul, in Chapman, lives. For Ovid's soul, now grown more old and wise, pours forth itself in deeper mysteries. St. Ovid, Iove's first gentle maester, died. He has a most notorious truant been. The gentle, Ovid's easy supple muse, which unto thee, sweet Chapman, she has done. She makes, in thee, the spirit of Ovid move, and calls thee, second maester of her love. Marlowe, the early dramatic London superstar, 5 years younger than Chapman, had ended already 2 years ago, in 1593, while Chapman's literary career in his 41st year, with his opus 2, Ovid's Banquet of Saints, in 1595, had just begun. This can neither become plausible nor logic. For Marlowe it is well documented that during his studies in Cambridge, he was a notorious truant, being half-time abroad, under royal commission. For example, in Reims, France, in Leiden, Holland, in Middleborough, Republic of the Seven United Netherlands, and many others. The excellency of Chapman's translations. Iliad by Homer. Georgics by Virgil. Works by Hesiod. Hero and Leander by Musaeus. Fifth Satire by Juvenal. His towering linguistic and literary qualities cannot be reconciled with Shakespeare's small Latin and less Greek. Do not also the allusions in the epistle of Chapman's Ovid's Banquet of Saints in 1595 clearly point to Marlowe's fatal destiny?
With that darkness, I will still labor to be shadowed, or, not affecting glory for mine own slight labors, but desirous, others should be more worthily glorious.
John Davis describes Maester George Chapman highly ambiguously as father of our English poets, whom he oddly does not know, personally, but by his pen, that is his writings, ranked him with the rarest, and put him in that rank in the front.
How can it have happened in 1611, that Chapman, and not Shakespeare, is termed the father of our English poets?
In Chapman's comedy, All Fools, in 1605, his intimate dedication to Thomas Walsingham, my long-loved friend, with a biographical outline of his own situation, let us actually identify Marlowe, but not Chapman. Read and listen.
Should I expose to every common eye the least allowed birth of my shaken brain, without my passport, patched with others' wit, my old fortune keep me still obscure.
In Chapman's successful first staged play, The Blind Beggar of Alexandria, in 1596, the protagonists and double nature Cleanthes, Iris create unmistakably a parable-like reference to the splitted identity and biography of its author, that is Marlowe, and to various literary contents, for example Tamburlaine. Listen. Already at the very beginning of the play, the Queen, Egeil, reveals to Iris. That is Marlowe's second identity. Ah, my Cleanthes. That is Marlowe's first identity. Where art thou become? But since I saved your guiltless life from death, and turned it only into banishment, I use thy skill to tell the drifts of fate, our fortunes and things, hid from sensual eyes, has sent me to thee for advertisement. Where Duke Leanth's lives, that was exiled. Is it coincidence that A.R. Brown Miller on the title page of his Chapman monography used an emblem with Marlowe's life motto? Ki me alit me extinguit? See arrows. Is it coincidence that the author's name, Chapman, was chosen, pointing to an evocative pseudonym, peddler, often used by the concealed poet genius Marlowe under various author pen names, when restarting his literary career, in 1593-94. Marlowe was the son of a cobbler, the name Chapman means a peddler. Is it coincidence that an obscure Robert Wilson was the author of The Cobbler's Prophecy in 1594, and The Peddler's Prophecy in 1595, at the same time, or that he could have belonged to the multiplicity of pen names of our poet genius? Let's finally reflect on Petowe's part of the hero and Leander Triple. Amazingly, in the same year in 1598, that, to this day, totally unknown author Henry Petowe wrote the second part or continuation of Hero and Leander. In reality, after Marlowe's first and Chapman's second part, it was, so to speak, Petowe's third part. No orthodox Shakespeare scholar will be able to explain why Petowe had a motive to begin his literary career, My First Fruits, with the further fortunes of Hero and Leander, and even continued some month later in 1599 with the fourth allegoric poem, presenting further revelations by a friend of Leander, Philocassander, and the queen, Elanira, that is Elizabeth I. Remember, Marlowe's poem Hero and Leander relates to the Greek legend Leander from Abydos, a swimming through the Hellespont to Hero, a priestess in Sestos, b. This figure can be found in the travel report of George Sands, printed in 1615, who started his travel in 1610. Any idea who George Sands or Sands may have been? Note the unthinkable. In Henry Petowe's dedication of Hero and Leander to Henry Guildford, the author, unmistakenly, discloses Marlowe's fatal destiny metaphorically.
That admired poet Marlowe, though not abruptly, yet contrary to all men's expectation, resting like a head, separated from the body. My liveless life when life was almost done. Done is my life and all my pleasure done. For he is gone, in whom my life begun. Unhappy I, poor I, and none as I. But pilgrim he, poor he, that should be by. My love exiled, and I in prison fast. Outstreaming tears break into weeping rain. He too soon banished, I in dungeon cast. He for me mourns, I for him complain. He is banished, yet lives at liberty. And I exiled, yet live in misery.
Note. As already mentioned, Petowe even continued Hero and Leander some month later in 1599 with a fourth allegoric poem, Philocassander and Deianira. There can be no doubt that Philocassander represents, allegorically, the spiritual friend or brother of Leander. Christopher Marlowe. Let's regard a few lines, enough to fully reveal the biographical background of the true author.
Strange kinds of death in life I try, to living die, and dying lift a mourn. Some said I was Leander, I leave for after worlds unborn, exiled me, I banished, exiled I was, for I was banished, banished from her sight. That once gave day unto my soul's dark night, how escapest you death? The Lord that kept me from thy sight, never on my life will he revive again.
Mm-hmm.